Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter. Welcome to those of you in church, and a special welcome to those of you online and on the phone, worshipping together with us today. And can I say a special thank you to those of you who have continued to worship at home, whereas I'm sure lots of you would love to have been in here in person, in order to leave the space for people to come in this morning. And we're very grateful. So thank you for being church from home with us together today. Those of you who are in church, can I please ask you to stay in your seats and stay seated until such time as a steward asks you to leave at the end. If for some reason you have some problem in the service, wave your arms and a steward will come to your assistance. But otherwise, please do stay where you are. You may have seen on the news yesterday the pictures of the police breaking up a church service where people weren't distanced properly. And here in St Andrews, over the last year, we've made a great effort, not just because it's the law, but because we want people to feel safe and at home worshipping with us. So let's not fall at the last hurdle, so to speak. Let's keep safe with one another this morning. This is a Holy Communion service because it's Easter Sunday. I'll be leading the first half, and Ken will preach and will celebrate communion with us. The church looks beautiful. We give great thanks to Jackie and her team for all that she has done with the flowers and everything. And as you may be able to see, we have the names of everyone that the lilies have been brought in remembrance of. I can't read them out because there are too many of them, but you all know, those of you who have lilies here in remembrance of a loved one, and we thank you for that. Those people are being celebrated in the beauty of our church this morning, which you can see online as well as here in the church. So it's Easter Day, and we will have our Easter acclamations. If we can have them up, please, Pete. So, alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. So let's steel our hearts and our minds as we come to our prayer of preparation. And we pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So let's have a moment of quiet before we join in the confession together, just to offer ourselves and our lives to God. So let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And we join together in the words of the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And the collect, the special prayer for Easter Day. Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him, grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory. To whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from the book of Acts, chapter 10, beginning at verse 34. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. This is the message God sent to the people of Israel, telling the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have." So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I'll hand over to Ken for our gospel reading and our sermon.
Our gospel reading comes from John chapter 10, reading verses 1 to 18. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped round Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now, Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them all that he had said, these things to her. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we have two quite different exclamations in our readings, but both with a global and an eternal perspective. Mary declares, "I have seen the Lord." And Peter states, "I now realize." Nothing extraordinary in these statements by themselves, but in the context, they are life-changing. Mary Magdalene had seen the Lord. In many ways, you kind of think, well, so what? All the disciples had seen him, but not at that stage after his resurrection. No one had seen him at that stage except Mary Magdalene. Peter and the other disciple had not seen the Lord. They had seen evidence he was no longer in the tomb, but they had not understood the significance at that time. Verse 9 of John's reading says, they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Or perhaps they were seeking to understand it in a practical way. Who had removed the body? Perhaps, as the Romans had feared, it had been stolen. And yet, the burial cloth and the linen wrapped around the head, they were left lying. It just doesn't make sense. It says those two disciples simply walked back. And in a way, you can almost hear the cogs in their brain going round as they try to work it out. But Mary had physically seen the Lord. Her Lord Jesus Christ. Our Lord Jesus Christ. And she had seen him post-resurrection. This meant that death had been defeated. The chains of hell of all that had hindered humanity were broken. And new life was available to all, then and now and always. All mourning, all sadness, all lack of hope can be put aside. All that we have suffered in this last year, we put in context with the freedom we have in Christ. Not that that was recognized immediately, because for a while, the faithful who Jesus did appear to believed this salvation was for the Jews only. They did not have God's vision for the whole world. They did not know God's compassion, his love for the whole of his creation. And in fact, there were many arguments within the early church about whether the Gentiles, so to speak, the unchosen, whether they could receive this grace of salvation. And that is where the context of Peter's statement of, I now realize, comes into play. Peter now realized that God has no favorites, that unlike the limitations of our human hearts and minds, God loves and reaches out and accepts everyone and everything in all creation when we turn to him. To say those lines again, I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. And that is why we celebrate today with the praise and acclamation of Mary as she rushes to declare that she has seen the Lord. So today, in many ways, as we celebrate Easter, as we shout hallelujah, but we don't shout because that would be false expiration, so we, you know what I mean. As we proclaim hallelujah, today marks the birth of hope, true hope, because the world has found its Messiah. And we know as we journey with the disciples and recognize who Jesus is, via his life and ministry, we recognize that this Messiah has come for the salvation of the whole world. Jesus Christ bridges the gap between us and God by his selflessness, by his servant nature, by turning the world's expectations on their head, even before proving himself as God with the power to be raised from death. And not as a temporary fix. Lazarus, Jesus' friend who he raised from death, was still to die again. He had to. He was but human. Jesus was fully human and fully divine, and in his godness, he defeated death and restored to us the opportunity of a real and proper relationship with God, which offers us both an eternal perspective, knowing that we can be in God's presence forever, but also in a day-to-day context where we are promised peace, Christ's peace, which is beyond the world's understanding. And so we have in our readings today total hope. I have seen the Lord, What a glorious declaration of faith. I have seen the Lord. I wonder if we've ever asked that for ourselves, that, you know, we want to actually see the Lord in that context. In that reading, we realize Mary Magdalene has. And she bubbles over with the excitement, with the emotion, as she rushes back to tell the disciples. And she tells all of them, including Peter and the other disciple, as he's described, those who had seen the evidence but were puzzled. They were puzzled by the resurrection. They didn't understand it at that time. The other disciple, he saw and believed, but even then he still did not understand that Christ had to rise from the dead. But I suppose one of the questions for us is, why did they not get it there and then? Was it perhaps because of their impatience? Should they have waited at the tomb as Mary did and waited? Should they have stopped, conversed, spoken about it, prayed, looked around? We don't know. What we are told is that they wandered back, puzzled. Or maybe this shows and confirms to us, and hopefully is an encouragement to us, that we all receive revelation in our own time and in our own way. Or rather, should we say, in God's time and in God's way, because he knows each one of us individually and uniquely. Those disciples received their revelation when it was right for them. And we hear those words of Peter, I now realize. For God is patient and allows us to come back to him, to his presence, time after time, as we have done in our confession this morning, as we will do when we share the Lord's Prayer later in the service. And I'm sure for many of us, we say the Lord's Prayer every day, a day where we return to God, offering everything up to him. At this moment, as we are well aware, we are going through steps on a roadmap. Steps dependent on certain things being in place by certain times before the next step is taken. And we know that these will only happen no earlier than certain specific dates. I've actually stopped using those dates. Now I just say step two, step three, just in case we miss those dates. But of course, what it means, people look at you quizzically and you've got to say April 12th, May 17th. Oh, right. But it's no earlier than, let's remember. We hope and pray, of course, that we get to these days, these dates and these steps. And yet, nothing is actually certain at this time. The resurrection story that we celebrate today gives us certainty, a true and certain hope of knowing God, of knowing his peace, the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all, as Peter says in that reading from Acts. This is a truth and a certainty that is open to each of us today. And I believe will help us through the difficulties that we've faced in the last year and as we go through today and into the future. Mary rushes to declare, I have seen the Lord. And Peter reminds us that Jesus commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God has appointed as judge of the living and the dead. The one with the ability to give life and life in all its fullness in this world and the next. As we share our faith today, as we worship together, and then hopefully share that outside these doors, outside these walls, outside the walls of your homes. May we truly be ready to rush out and declare that Jesus Christ is Lord of heaven and earth and come into the world for us. So as we celebrate this joyful Easter day, take time before you rush out to pause, to wait, to see and hear once more the voice of our loving God, reaching into our individual as well as our global situations with whatever levels of confusion, fear or anxiety or trust that we have. And then we respond by taking that love he offers us as he calls to us and holds us. So I pray as you are encouraged, as you are stirred to say hallelujah, and if you are at home, to shout it out. Be called afresh this morning. Share the good news with all those you encounter, and know God's peace. Amen.
So as we celebrate God's roadmap of love for all creation, we join together in proclaiming that in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And Lynn will now lead us in prayer.
Let us pray together, whether in church this morning or following online at home. We give thanks that we can join together. Jesus, the resurrection and the life, we give you thanks for all those who have lived and believed in you. In happiness and hope, let us pray together to the Father that our risen Saviour may fill us with the joy of his glorious life-giving resurrection. Help make the purpose of the resurrection personal to us, to help and inspire the way we live each day. Help make us better disciples by what we do for others. Strengthen our belief so that we might continue enjoying spiritual treasures as we rest in the promise of the life to come. Lord, we are living in a time unlike anything we have ever seen. Before chaos, confusion, turmoil has been the experience. We pray for a time when our lives can return to being able to mix more closely together and to be able to be with our loved ones. We pray that the vaccine rollout that will be enabled to achieve this, and that the vaccine reaches all so that everyone may benefit, especially in poorer countries. We ask that those in authority will work together, that there will be consideration given to all throughout the world. We think of your church today and of the risen Lord as nations celebrate all over the world. We pray to the Father that those who are isolated and those who live in areas of persecution may find strength in the good news of Easter. Lord of love, grant your world peace where there are conflicts and where communities are broken, and let that love be known and bring hope to those who are suffering. We pray today as well for the conflicts and the protests and demonstrations that have been taking place, and particularly pray where violence has broken out. And we ask for calm in these areas, and in particular with those in Northern Ireland. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for our government and those in authority who are making decisions affecting us all, that they will be equipped to lead, to act honestly and with humility and compassion. There are so many difficult decisions which need to take place to provide a fair society and to remove the suffering which may be felt. Lord, we are all different and all have different ideas. Let everyone learn from your Lord and Peter's quote, "Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality." Let your love for everyone help us to love our neighbour and show respect for all and care about the feelings of others. Give us patience with the way in which we are leading our lives at present due to the pandemic, especially as we start to come out of lockdown. Let us pray for those who have been especially struggling with life, whether worrying about relatives and friends who may have contracted COVID, whether due to living in restricted accommodation without outdoor space, whether feeling the worry and frustration of waiting for medical procedures, whether worrying about their jobs and if they will still be employed, or whether struggling with their mental health. We ask for your strength, Lord, to help us through this trying time. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray and give thanks for our clergy and all those involved in delivering the online services and providing the technology to enable us to reach out. We give thanks for the initiatives used in adapting to online delivery, not only for the services, but also keeping many of our church groups going, including the activities which have been developed for the young in our community. As schools take a break for the Easter holidays, we ask that teachers can take a well-deserved break after experiencing the difficulties of teaching online for most of the term and then returning to teaching in schools and the worry they may have about contracting COVID. We also bring before you the work of all key workers as they continue to provide the essential services we need. Lord, in your mercy. Let us continue to consider in our prayers the work of the NHS and give thanks for all those who care for the sick and that you bring them resilience to be able to manage the challenging workload. Lord, help us to work together as a nation to bring this virus to an end and enable us to lead a more social life with one another. Let us pray for all those who are suffering. God of compassion, be close to those who are ill, worried, or lonely in their loneliness. Lord, we ask that you be there to comfort and to give hope to those who are anxious and be the light in their lives. We give thanks for those who work in hospices, who can, in a peaceful place, offer compassionate care. We pray for everyone affected by the loss of a loved one, and pray for all families and friends who are grieving for those whose lives they cherished. We hold them in our hearts, Lord, knowing that you hold them in yours. In the quiet, please bring to God anyone known to you and in need of your prayers at this time. As we seek to live our lives according to your example, help us by your presence to grow in this way. Heavenly Father, you have delivered us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your Son. Grant that as his death has recalled us to life, so his continual presence in us may bring us to eternal joy. Merciful Father,
And so we come to share the peace. Those in church, please stay seated where you are. We can wave or just greet one another, but nothing other than that. Those at home, feel free to do what you like within the confines of worship, of course. But wherever we are, we proclaim the peace to one another across the airwaves and through the church, whether we're on our own with others or here on either side of the aisle. So the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Take them off.
As we turn to our Eucharistic prayer, hopefully everything will work as it did before. Just looking down, remembering all those extra bits that we need. We've got the tweezers, we've got everything else. It will be receiving in one kind only, receiving the bread, which is still covered at the moment, so that reduces the aerosol expiration danger there. I will receive the bread and the wine on your behalf in that respect. While, for folk at home, while people are receiving communion in the building, the words of the spiritual communion will be up on the screen for you. And also to mention that we will be having a choir, an Easter anthem from the choir this morning. That's got a few of them looking in church. But they're not there, we can't see them. But by the miracles and of modern technology and enthusiasm of Hannah, which we are thankful for, the choir have all recorded, I don't even know the name for it, Bill, but I can't, or rather I probably did know it and I can't remember it now, but they've recorded the anthem in the individual space in their own home, and Hannah has brought it all together. So we are blessed to be receiving an Easter anthem from the choir this morning, and we are very, very grateful to them for putting that effort in. So thank you, Bill, if you can pass on our thanks when you see them for your next practice warble on a Sunday afternoon. Thank you. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts, we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father. And in these days of Easter, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell and restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise and opened to them the gate of life eternal. And so in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory as we say together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and to serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. O Christ, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, with thanksgiving. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. And so, having recalled the cost of this meal, we do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. In a moment, we say together our prayer of thanksgiving after communion, but first our post-communion acclamation. God of life, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection have delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may ever more live with him in the joy of his risen life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And so we come to our notices. So forgive me while I get the, you know, it's going to be longer than you're hoping for when I have to get the stand back out, but there's a few. But of course, the joyful thing in all of this is that we have banns of marriage to be read, which is excellent. And forgive me, I'm just going to check that there's no extra messages. So I haven't had any notification of any extra birthdays or celebrations since the service began. But we have banns of marriage, and so I published the banns of marriage between Ryan John Bowyer and Sarah Kerry Louise Aitchison, both of St. Albans Parish in Romford, and between Daryl Anthony Page and Olivia May Crowther, both of St. Peter's and St. Paul's Parish in Grays, and between Adam David Calcutt and Mary Elizabeth Hewitt, again, both of St. Peter's and St. Paul's Parish in Grays. This is for the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it. Excellent. Is the right answer. And so let's pray for these three couples, but also for Timothy and Olafunke, who will be getting married in church in April as well. And so, Lord, we thank you for Timothy and Olafunke, for Ryan and Sarah, for Daryl and Olivia, and for Adam and Mary. We thank you that they have chosen to commit themselves to each other in holy matrimony. And we pray that as they go through these final weeks of preparation, with all the restrictions and all the extra thinking that they've had to do, that, Lord, they will be even more confirmed in their desire to exchange those vows, to commit to a lifelong relationship and union with one another, with you at the center. And so, Lord, we pray your blessing on each of these couples. Pray that they will know your peace and know your joy as they come to their wedding days. Amen. So while we're celebrating, any birthdays or anniversaries that anyone is celebrating? Which one, bigger or smaller there? Helen, it's Helen's birthday, fantastic. Is that today? Helen's birthday is today. Laurie's was a couple of days ago. Karen's was yesterday. It's obviously the time for birthdays. Helen, happy birthday. Is it yours, Alexandra? No, it's not. Oh, but it's just thumbs up for birthdays. Excellent, good, that's excellent. Well, have a great day, enjoy it, and as part of all the celebrations of the day, happy birthday. And anyone else who is celebrating this weekend or this week, have a great time celebrating. It is indeed Marlene's birthday as well, but I had asked her whether I should share it and she said no. Oh well. While we're at it, I'm not sure Mike's watching, but Mike, our groundsman, it was his birthday yesterday as well, and it was Marlene's yesterday. There's a slew of them at this time of year. Anyway, let's move on quickly, I think. Thanks, Peter. Actually, there is one more thing to celebrate this morning as well, because in the Lich Gate, as you exit this morning, there are some Easter goodies for you to help yourself from Messy Church. So bless Messy Church for all that they have provided for. There's been about 50 boxes, I think, looking over at Christine. There's been 50 boxes that went out for this Holy Week for families to join in with. And if some of you have been walking through the churchyard, there is actually an Easter trail through the churchyard, which you can take part in, regardless of whether you've got that box or not. But as I say, there are some goodies apparently in the Lich Gate, so help yourselves. It will be staffed, so it's not entirely, you know, just, oh, we'll have all of that. They'll explain it, how it works when you get there. As you can tell, the church building is now open for Sunday services, and we pray will remain so. For the time being, it will still just be the 10:15 service as we see how we work coming out of lockdown in general. But we will now be open on Thursdays from 10 till 2 for private prayer as well. So 10 till 2, private prayer on Thursdays. And obviously within all of that, we will be attempting to keep everyone as safe as possible as they come in and exit the building. We're maintaining our one-way system, which I'll explain again as we prepare to leave. The office is still contactable by phone or email. There are, of course, many resources online. You can check into our own website or check the Church of England, the diocesan website, lots and lots of different ways to engage through this time. If you're wanting a pastoral call, a prayer or whatever, please do call 07895 512 480. 07895 512 480. And if you leave a message, you will be got back to for prayer and a conversation. So if you get the answer phone, which you will do, don't not leave a message. That's what we're saying there. Please leave a message and someone will get back to you. And also, if you know someone who hasn't been able to engage in any shape or form online with church, there is the Hope Church of England number, 0800 804 8044. And I know we had some stats a couple of weeks ago on different online resources, but apparently that Hope line has had millions and millions of calls and has obviously been very well used over the last year. Okay, I think that's, you'll be pleased to know, I think that's most of what I was going to say. I don't think there's anything major I need to say apart from that. That's great. Apart from coffee is still online afterwards on Zoom, get the link via the Facebook page, and family time will be on in due course as well. And of course, we are hugely grateful to all of you who have continued your giving to the mission and ministry of this church and the wider church throughout this time. And we continue to receive your giving in any shape or form that you wish to give, by check made payable to Horn Church PCC, signing up to the parish giving scheme, or using the Just Giving button on the website. But we are hugely grateful, and the church wouldn't operate without the giving of our congregation. So let's give thanks for all that we have received. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the generosity, for your generosity that gives us so much. And we pray that we may be generous in giving back to you, to your work here on earth. So we pray your blessing on all that we have received, that it may be used for your greater glory and the good of all people. Amen. I think we're almost there. Our psalm for today, 118. Now, some of the psalm was used last week as well. It's a triumphal psalm, so it suits both the Palm Sunday and also this Sunday. I'm just going to use a few lines from it, though, just to encourage you as you go out into the world this week. Encouraged, hopefully, by shouting hallelujah, by rejoicing in the resurrection, and rejoicing in knowing that this was all planned, that the words of this psalm were relevant for when it was first written, relevant for Christ's resurrection and when he was in the world, relevant for us in this time. Psalm 118, verse 14. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. Verse 19. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. And that's whether it's this building or your own home, you enter the gates to give thanks. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. And so let's receive the blessing of God as we prepare to go. May Christ, who out of defeat brings new hope and a new future, fill you with his new life, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. And let's add in, behind your masks, a little bit quieter than you'd normally do. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Be safe and know God's blessings. Amen.